Welcome in, everybody, to LakersNation.com post-game show. My name is Sean Davis, filling in for, I said post-game show. See, we're already off to a rocking hot start. Filling in for Trevor Lane here tonight. The Lakers pick up a big win, closing out the road trip, beating the Washington Wizards 125-120. Welcome you guys in from YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter. We'll be breaking down this game and reacting to this game, which was an ugly win, but this late into the season, with this road trip, a win is a win. A win is a win. Trevor is out with family tonight, enjoying the night off. So, Trevor, hope you enjoy the night with the fam. But joining me tonight, good friend Jeff Spiegel from Dodger Blue, who's with me on playback tonight, watching the game. Jeff, how you doing, man?
We'll get into some gambling losses that took place by a guy that I've never heard of before at the end of this Wizards game. But on the whole, a win is a win on the road, 5-1 road trip. So we're things are looking up. Things are looking up for me and for the Lakers.
Absolutely. Let's take a look at the box score first from tonight's game. Anthony Davis was absolutely phenomenal tonight. 35 points, 18 rebounds, 2 steals, 3 blocks, 10 of 17 shooting. Jeff, you had a great stat after the first quarter that Anthony Davis had the most free throw attempts at the end of the first quarter out of anybody this season. He was perfect from the line. He was spectacular. LeBron James, 25, 7-9, efficient shooting. Rui, spectacular again, 19-7. And then D'Lo and Austin, 18 for D'Lo, 16 points for Austin Reeves. This was a really, really ugly game. And yeah, I guess first, glad that they were able to come out with the win. And Jeff, we said that the Lakers needed to go 5-1 on this road trip, and they got that. And yeah, that's why I'm okay with the win, regardless of how ugly it was.
Yeah, look, at this point in the year, it's not a beauty contest. At the end of the day, they're walking out of Washington with a win. We're going to get into the end of the game situation, LeBron and Anthony Davis having to check back in. Not exactly how you draw that up if you're Darvin Ham, but a win is a win. 16 turnovers, yes, but they won. Looking at this box score, the thing that jumps out to me, Sean, 5 starters, all 5 with 16 or more points. That's the type of balanced attack that the Lakers need. And guys shooting a good percentage. I mean, the worst percentage shot was D'Angelo Russell going 7 of 16, 4 of 10 from deep. And that's pretty solid. Like, you'll take that from D'Angelo Russell. And so just an overall, a really solid shooting performance from the Lakers. Some things they could have tightened up, but back-to-back, on the road, last game in a 6-game road trip. Take the win, be happy, move on.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, another thing that pops out, and we can get to this with the bench. One of the things that have been talked about recently a lot is the bench scoring, and if that is really a concern. Jeff, you look at the Lakers bench tonight. Torian Prince, 5 points in 16 minutes. Jackson Hayes, 3 points in 10 minutes. And Spencer Dinwiddie, 4 points in 19 minutes. That adds up to only 12 points from the Lakers bench. How concerned do you think we should be about the bench, or are you not really concerned at all about the bench scoring going forward?
I think it's a concern. I mean, based on the fact that these guys took 13 shots and what'd you say? They had 12 points. Look, the Lakers relied on their starters a lot. Anthony Davis, 38 minutes. I mean, I was talking to you on the playback. Anthony Davis is 7th in the NBA in minutes played this year, played the entire first quarter, as we talked about, 38 minutes finally. So, I mean, the fact that they can rely on their starters is great, but yeah, I think on any given night, they just need one of these guys. Is it Torian Prince? Is it Spencer Dinwiddie? Is it Gabe Vincent? Is it, you know, Jared Vanderbilt when he comes back? They need one, I think, guy at least off the bench who can score. Like, some of those guys will give them solid defensive minutes and solid sort of like not be a liability necessarily on both ends of the floor. But yeah, there's not going to be a ton of teams that you're going to be able to get away with 12 total bench points against.
Yeah, I mean, even if you look at the Wizards bench, I mean, 6 points from Anthony Gill. Don't, yeah, what it was 6, 10, 13, 20, 26, and then what, 35 bench points?
Yeah.
Like that, I mean, again, that just scoring, what was it, 12 points from your bench just isn't sustainable. And there's been a bunch of really good suggestions. So some people are more fans of just throwing Austin to the bench, or one of Austin / D'Lo, and letting when Vando gets back, or letting Gabe come in for, or Spencer in replace for one of them. and letting Austin and D'Lo come off the bench. I just think personally, I think you really just need to stagger the lineups and make sure that like there is legit, there is two players on the floor that can score the basketball at all times, because you're not getting much production from this bench right now. I guess Dinwiddie can do it, but Dinwiddie's been a lot more hesitant with his shot selection since he's been here.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's definitely, I think, something that we need to monitor for. Yeah.
Dinwiddie, you mentioned it. I mean, Dinwiddie, Gabe Vincent, like Jared Vanderbilt, when he comes back. I mean, we don't look at Vanderbilt as an offensive guy, but you just need, like, Dinwiddie's role is to be sort of a creator, you would think, on the when he's on the floor. Hey, give us a break, get some points. Obviously, Gabe Vincent has been rusty offensively. So can one or both of those guys become a threat offensively? Vanderbilt be the sort of the other guy that's in that eight-man rotation with a big, I'm with you. I think you're right to point it out as a concern. And again, when you beat the Wizards by five, you shouldn't take away a ton positively from that.
Yeah. Mamadou here with a super chat says the bench blew the lead. Not even going to like talk about the stats here, but Jeff, it just felt like there was a certain rhythm that this game had.
Yeah.
And it really, really feels like whenever AD was off the floor, whenever Rui was off the floor, Lakers had a really tough time getting stops. It is really finding any sort of like rhythm. And I do think that's partially because Jackson, I mean, look at this. Plus minus, by the way, is a really awful stat.
Yeah.
Especially for an individual game. But good grief, man. Jackson Hayes was a minus 24 in 10 minutes.
In a game they won.
Yes. So,
but I mean, look at those guys. Every single one of them except for Dinwiddie's negative. So the Lakers were worse when every single one of their bench players, not just worse than when they're starters, they were worse than the Wizards when those guys were on the floor, which tells you everything you need to know.
Yeah, absolutely not a good game from the bench. Legend with a super chat says, shameless coaching, one timeout on a failed challenge. You think this was a bad game from Darvin Ham? Or how much should we criticize Darvin for tonight's game?
Yeah, I mean, look, we were talking, if you were watching this game closely, early in the game, the Lakers, I mean, the Wizards had like 19 points in the first 4 minutes of the game, and you were calling for a timeout. They call the timeout, and then the Lakers come out on like a 25-4 run or something like that the rest of the quarter. So, but I said, hey, did Darvin Ham do anything there? Like, did they change anything? Or is it just sort of, hey, wake up, you know, like slow them down a little bit, get focus on defense, that kind of thing. So I don't know. I mean, there's people, we get it on our Dodgers show all the time. They just want to blame the guy they don't like. People don't like Darvin Ham. They want to blame him. I don't know. I don't see any. The one thing, I guess, Sean, was there was critique in the playback about how long it took to get Rui back into the game in the fourth quarter. But, I mean, look, they ended up, the lead was back up to 13 with a minute 15 to go. So you could kind of make a case that waiting to put Rui in, even if the lead shrunk, eventually the lead got way back up to 13. So I don't know. I didn't see anything egregious from Darvin tonight, I guess is my a long way of saying that.
I do think that they waited a long time to get Rui back in there. I do think that is a justified criticism. I could be surfing Sean's favorite ingredients, mayo, FYI. Cliff says, we really traded KCP and Kuz for Russ. Spencer's body language was strange. I didn't notice anything particularly strange about Spencer Dinwiddie's body language. But yeah, the Russ Brick trade, I really think pushed this team back 2 years at minimum, if not more.
Yeah,
that's how bad that was.
Look, I said it on the live. I love Kuz. I mean, he's just a guy I'll always root for. So sad to see him go. Apparently, he likes DC. He at least likes the money. He's getting paid to play in DC. But yeah, that one will forever be an L.
Let's see. Another super chat here says the Lakers are a funny team for allowing teams to make these big runs. It's so bad, I'm not even mad anymore. LOL. Jeff, I think even though the Lakers, like how the game started and I mean, just how the game even got throughout, even when it got really, really sloppy in the third and obviously throughout that fourth, I'll speak for myself for sure. There was never a point in this game, even when it got down to two, there was never a point in this game where I was like, the Lakers are going to lose this. Was that the same for you or?
100%. I mean, we talked about like, even when they were up four, I think it was in the second or third quarter, it was like, it didn't feel that close. It never felt like the Lakers were out of control. Although I think there was one moment in the second half when the Wizards had the ball down by two and they missed the three. And it was like, holy smokes, they actually have a chance to grab the lead. But yeah, I mean, look, we could talk about this later. I bet the live line midway through the game because I'm looking at it and I'm like, -7.5. Like, I know they're only up two, but geez Louise, they're going to kill this team in the last 8 or 9 minutes. And well, didn't go so well for me, Sean.
Was it Julian or Justin Champagne? I forget.
Justin Champagne is a person I just recently learned of. This fellow decided to hit back-to-back three-pointers in the last, like, 55 seconds of the game to take a 13-point lead and, in conjunction with another layup, make it a 5-point lead, which, in case math is not your strong suit, is less than 7.5. And as a result, your boy taking the L's because of a guy named Justin Champagne. So there you go. Rookie out of Pitt, I'm told, Sean. Was he drafted?
I'm not sure. Second round pick, maybe? Second rounder?
I got no draft pick anywhere on here. So
you got some members of the chat with you on this one. Fame Network says that they took the 7.5 too.
Yeah. Well, I apologize. Hopefully you weren't listening to me and taking that bet because good Lord. Guy's a 31% three-point shooter and decides to go 2 for 2 in the last minute. Unbelievable.
We have some good news here. So Ghostfire with a comment says, when will Vando play? So the good news that we heard today is that Jared Vanderbilt is expected to be reevaluated early next week. Now, does that mean a return to play during the regular season is likely? No, the last game of the regular season is next Saturday against the New Orleans Pelicans. But I do think if everything goes smoothly with Vanda's reevaluation next week, that you could talk about a play-in game appearance for Jared Vanderbilt, which would be massive for this team's defense.
Does that worry you trying to sort of work? I mean, we're talking about Gabe Vincent and kind of how rusty he looks. He missed a lot more time, obviously, than Vanderbilt will have missed. But does it worry you to try and sort of mess with your rotation a little bit at that point in the season? And if it's a play-in game, literally a winner-go-home type situation?
For Vando, weirdly, I don't think so, because I think there is a more plug-and-play fit with Vando, just in terms like a gap being in the rotation, where Gabe coming back kind of messed up the rotation a little bit, where they're like trying to force it, and not like he's been bad or anything. But I feel like to really get Gabe minutes, you would have had to force him in there. And I think Vando being able to come back, you don't need anything from him on the offensive end.
Yeah.
Just come back in, play good defense. There is a spot, there's a gap of minutes that you can just give right away to Jared Vanderbilt. Personally, I think it'll be a pretty easy fit personally.
Yeah. No, I mean, I could see that, like a point guard versus a wing guy that's not really part of your offense. Obviously, with Vincent, we're saying it's the offense that's taking a while to sort of click. And so I think you make a good point with Vanderbilt that the defense is going to be plug and play, and you're not really running the ball through them on offense anyways. So I think that's a fair point.
Let's get to this. First award of the night.
Superstar of the night.
Superstar of the night. Chat, let us know what we're thinking here. Although I think there's only one answer. In case you need the stat of the box score again, I'll show it to you.
You just keep zooming in until only the first name on that list shows up. I think, Sean, I think we're going to be safe on that one.
It's not letting me zoom in anymore. Otherwise, I would have.
Yeah. I mean, Anthony Davis was incredible tonight. Started from the get-go. We talked about it earlier. 11 for 11 from the free throw line in the first quarter alone. I think he had like 16 points maybe in the first quarter. Obviously finishes with 35 and 18, 3 blocks, 2 steals, an assist. Doesn't miss from the free throw line. I mean, like there's literally no holes you can poke. He was efficient. He made all his free throws, 18 rebounds, 2 steals, 3 blocks, only 2 turnovers, just one foul.
Yeah.
With 3 blocks and 18 rebounds. That's insane. Plus 29 for a stat that we all think is terrible. But crazy, crazy, crazy good night from Anthony Davis tonight.
Yeah. I mean, Anthony Davis, I'm never going to read the stat sheet again. But Anthony Davis, we talk about Vando's defensive impact. Gabe, I think, has been fine defensively, and he's helped out in his very limited minutes since he's came back. But Anthony Davis right now is this team's defense. Yeah. Like, when Anthony Davis is not on the floor, defensively, this team looks really, really rough. And he made so many impactful plays defensively. Even if he doesn't get the block, there's times where just his presence at the rim deters the shot, maybe causes the guard or whoever's driving to the basket to make a different angle on their shot that makes the shot a little bit tougher. And AD's impact defensively, I think, is so important. Get Vando back, hopefully, but 35 points. I mean, the media just does not appreciate this guy enough. How many dudes can pretty semi-consistent? I feel like three times a month, at least, we're talking 35, 15, and 5 stocks. Like, that is insane efficiency from Anthony. And he's doing it on efficient numbers. Like, I'm going to read off Anthony Davis's numbers really, really quickly this season. We, as a fan base, we are critical of AD at times, and rightfully so to a certain extent. But this season, 24.6 points, 12.7 rebounds, 3.5 assists, and then you tack on to that, just 2.5 blocks and a steal per game.
Yeah.
That is ridiculous on 55% shooting from the floor.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, 15th in scoring, 3rd in rebounding, 5th in blocks. And to your point, doing it at an efficient rate.
He's been available. He's played in 71 games this year. You brought up the stat where he's 7th in minutes, not including tonight.
Yeah, 7th in minutes. So total minutes. Obviously, you've got guys that have like a higher minutes per game or whatever. But total minutes, I believe he's 7th.
Yeah. Like, come on, man. We got to stop with some of the AD hatred. That is a national media rant right there, if you will.
No, I think it's a fair one.
All right, let's get back to some of you guys' questions and comments. That's Suga with a super chat says, something about this team. I just don't like the makeup of our group. A lot of young guys play like a young-minded team. If we don't get out of the ninth seed, man, might not make it, not going to lie, and deserve it. So essentially what this super chat is saying, they think this team is too young. Maybe not. They don't have enough experience with this group. And if they're not able to get out of the ninth seed and maybe jump up to the eighth seed, that they might go home early. Might not even get to the playoffs. Yeah. Jeff, do you agree with that? Do you think that this team is too like young-minded, if you will?
That's the part I struggle. I mean, I go back. I was like, maybe I'm missing something. I mean, if we're talking about an 8-man rotation that's Davis, Hachimura, LeBron, D'Angelo, Austin Reeves, Spencer Dinwiddie, Gabe Vincent, you know, Vando, and then take your pick of backup bigs. Like, none of those guys are young, you know? So,
and what, 6 of those guys were on the Western Conference Finals team last year, and another one went to the finals on another team?
Yeah. So, the young-minded team, I mean, I think it's fair to have, like, I think the rest of this about what if we don't get out of the ninth seed, we might not make it, like, that kind of thing, I think is fair, and that it speaks to the competition that's going to be around them in that play-in situation. But we might land in the same place said, but I think we're going to get there in different ways.
Yeah. Now I do think that, again, the young-minded part, I don't agree with, but as BC here, even is like making a good point. I'm going to pull up the standings here in just a sec. Another good way to just like get to a standings poll anyway. The Lakers, if they are in a situation where they are the 9 seed. Now, the one thing I do think I've been correct is it's going to be hard. The Lakers have the worst road record of all the top 10 teams. Hard to win 2 straight road playing games. It wouldn't be 2 straight road playing games. They would host the first playing game. So I think that is the statement you do have incorrect. But in general, but still, the point still kind of
game is 7 versus 8 and 9 versus 10, right?
Yes, with the 9 hosting the 9-10 part of that matchup.
Yeah.
And yes, will it be tough? Sure, because you have to win both games to make it to the playoffs. But you host the first game. You host that first game. And you, in terms of win total, you have the tied second best home record. If we're just going off of wins in the West, only team that's outright better is Denver, and you're tied with Minnesota. So. But you do make the point about the road game. So let's say you win the 9-10, but you got to go on the road to Sacramento, for example. Yeah. Your road record, you have the least amount of road wins in the top 10. So that is definitely a concern. But, and I think this is something we could talk about now, Jeff. You are currently 2 games back of the 6th seed.
Two back of the 5. Come on, Sean. Don't undersell it. 2 games back of the 5 seed, baby.
I'm saying two games back of the six because Dallas has the tiebreaker.
Okay, fair.
Two games back of the six. You play New Orleans the last game of the year.
Yeah.
Sacramento plays Phoenix the second to last game of the year.
Yep.
You own the season series against Phoenix. Phoenix plays tonight against Cleveland. It can get really, really, really interesting in this Western Conference play-in race where, I mean, New Orleans is really, they dropped two in a row. They're getting blasted right now. I thought I had the score, but it was 91-76. We guys can see it at the top of the screen right there at the end of the third quarter. So we go back here to the standings. New Orleans keeps getting pushed down. I don't have their schedule put up in front of me, but they play. Oh my God. They all play each other. Jeff's New Orleans plays Phoenix April 7th and Sacramento April 11th. And you brought up on the playback stream earlier that Phoenix plays Sacramento on April 12th. It could get really, really, really interesting.
Yeah. I mean, keep in mind the Lakers, but the Lakers, you know, it's not smooth sailing for the Lakers. We're talking about five games to go. So for you to make up two games with five to go, even if you go 5-0, even if you go 5-0, you know, you're still looking at other teams needing to go 3-2, something. And you've got to jump two teams in between you. You know, it's not, you're not two games back of the team right in front of you, that kind of a thing. So,
yeah. So the Lakers right now, they sit at 44-33. You look at this upcoming schedule, you have a three-game homestand, your last three home games of the year. You got Cleveland at home on Saturday, really, really early start time, 12:30 Pacific. Then you got Minnesota, second half of back-to-back at home. And then you got Golden State at home. And then you have two road games at Memphis on April 12th, which you would like to count as a guaranteed win.
Yeah,
and
they just beat the Wizards by five, but we'll count it. True. We'll count it.
And then you have New Orleans last game of the year, which we just broke down, could be really, really pivotal.
I mean, what's your prediction? You look at that. We're giving Memphis a win. Like, is this team going 4-1 in that stretch?
I was gonna say, like, if you want any outside shot at the six seed or for sure the seven, you gotta get 4-1 with the four wins being like these last four. Like
Right.
You could take the Cleveland loss.
Like, well, Minnesota's the second night of a back-to-back. You've got Minnesota, true, a team that still has the one seed in play.
So, like, if you went 4-1 and you split these two and then you just won out these last three, you have a shot. You have a shot.
Yeah.
I think the minute we talk about you losing a second game, you kill any outside shot of a six seed, you probably kill your chances for a seven seed too.
Yeah, I mean, literally, you've got one easy game in those last five. You know, you'd love to look it up and be like, you know, have a couple of the games that the Lakers just finished. But even Golden State, I mean, that's not going to be an easy one.
Yeah.
Like, Memphis, the funny part is you get the two nights off, then you play Memphis, then you get another night off. So that you get the nice buildup for that New Orleans game. But it's no cakewalk for the Lakers. And they got, again, it's not just two games behind seven seed. You've got the eighth and the ninth teams, right? Or, you know, whatever it is. The seven and the eight teams right in front of them as well.
Yeah. And now, again, the good news, I guess, for the Lakers is there's going to be some, like, push down anyway because they all play each other.
Yeah.
Phoenix has a game against Sacramento and New Orleans. That's actually back-to-back, I want to say, for Phoenix. Or maybe it was Sacramento. But that is the upside, if you will, is that somebody's going to push somebody else down. So long as the Lakers take care of business and win, which is why we said you got to beat Golden State, Memphis, and New Orleans, there is some opportunity there to jump up.
Yeah.
All right. Patrick with a super chat. Why didn't Ham call a timeout at all on that long run of the Wizards in the fourth quarter? It really scared me a lot. Yeah, I will say I do think they were late to that timeout. I thought they were the bigger thing, really, because I just thought it just needed to be the Lakers, just mentality-wise, just get back to playing defense like we said in the first quarter. But I just think they put Rui back in way too late. I think that was the bigger mistake. I think leaving Rui out for that long was the bigger mistake than necessarily calling a timeout. Because I think if the Lakers would just play better, I mean, lock in and really – I know Dell play better. We're more paying attention to detail defensively. I think they would have been fine. But yeah, I guess you could say call timeout. But Rui, I think you just need to get Rui back in quicker, personally.
Yeah, we joked on the playback. The irony is Washington called the timeout right when we were hoping the Lakers would to give Washington's LeBron and AD a break, and B, it lets them get Rui back in. So
Washington's on this insane run. Lakers, I think it's out of bounds off the Lakers. We're just gonna take that timeout right quick. Immediately Rui gets back into the game.
Yeah.
7-0 run.
Crazy.
Good grief. Which I think because of how we've talked about him, that makes this award pretty easy.
Star in your role.
Star in your role goes to the player that is not one of the two stars, LeBron or AD, but had the best performance of the night to help contribute to the Lakers' victory. Pull back up the box score here one more time in case we need to. There's only three candidates. It's the other three starters. You have Rui Hachimura, 19 points and 7 rebounds in 27 minutes. Incredible efficiency as usual for Rui. And we no Popeyes. Go away. D'Angelo Russell, 18 points, 7 of 16 shooting, 4 threes as well. He started off red hot. And Austin Reeves, 16 points, 4 boards, 4 assists, 7 of 15 shooting on this game. Jeff, who you going with your starting role?
It's Rui pretty comfortably for me, and we'll talk about him in a second. I do think you mentioned D'Angelo Russell. I want to give him sort of a shout-out, honorable mention here, just because, look, the Wizards got out to a hot start in this one. The Lakers were down early. It was D'Angelo that kind of pulled them out of it, had a couple heat check threes from way, way deep. And so shout out to D'Angelo Russell. But look, 9 of 12, 7 boards. I can't argue with that. Rui was clearly the third most important guy on the Lakers tonight.
Yeah, normally me and Trevor, we would try to disagree. I don't think you can. I think Rui, and we've kind of talked about it the entire show thus far, Jeff.
Yeah.
Just Rui's impact on the game. This was a different game when Rui was in there. I felt like after the first stint, I think everybody was kind of off. But like you said, and give D'Lo his credit, when D'Lo got those couple of shots going, the Lakers call that timeout where they kind of make that mentality switch. And then from that point on, it was just a completely different game when Rui was in the game. Yeah. And I think another thing that needs to be noted is, so Rui on the season, he's averaging 4 rebounds a game. Throughout his career, he's averaging 4.8 rebounds per game. In the last 10 games, Rui Hachimura is averaging 17 points and 6 rebounds, including multiple double-doubles, while shooting 63% from the field, 47% from 3, and 85% from the line. He's been, I don't know, man. I think that's all right. It's okay.
Yeah. Jeez.
He's been ridiculously efficient, man. And even if you go for, I can't do the month of April just start, but for the month of March, where he finally started getting like real minutes, he averaged 32 minutes a game, and those numbers are 17 and 5 on 59%, 47%, 77% shooting, like. He's been ridiculously efficient, and shout out to him for really starting to put more of an effort into the defensive glass or to the rebounding glass in general.
Yeah, yeah. No, great stuff. Great stuff from Rui. Efficiency's the name of the game with him. And, you know, there are games when it sometimes flies under the radar and you just look up and again, it's like, holy smokes, he's shooting 75% from the floor, grabbing rebounds at a high rate and just kind of disrupting things. His size and his length is one of those things that doesn't even show up in the box score. The impact that it has on other teams. And so it's great stuff from Rui tonight and well-deserving of that star in your role.
Quick update. The Pelicans are down 19 now with 7:56 to go. So all things go well, the Lakers will be, what, 1.5 games back then of the Pelicans? So, and like we said, they do meet last game of the season. So could be interesting.
Good stuff.
Could be interesting. Sean Sanders with Super Chat says we have the worst bench in the NBA. Facts. Yeah, I mean, we talked about it. Like the bench scoring is a problem. There are games where Torian goes on a heater, maybe Jackson Hayes chips in 8 points off of, you know, lobs and things of that nature. But when you have a game like this, like the bench can get rough. And I guess it just more so talks about like the floor of this team's bench. Like when it's bad with the bench scoring, it can get really, really bad. And tonight, Jeff, it really felt like, if it's not the starters on the floor, Yeah. This team isn't scoring, and this team isn't getting stops either.
Yeah, just trying to do a quick search. It looks like they're bottom five in bench scoring, the Lakers are this season, which will surprise nobody. Obviously, part of that is because of how top-heavy this Lakers team is. You look at those top five guys, it's pretty crazy sort of how much they rely on those guys, and yet it's totally understandable when it's AD and LeBron and that type of thing. And so, I think Dinwiddie's going to be sort of an X factor a little bit, because when we're talking about scoring off the bench, and he's got the size and length to be effective on the other side as well. He's a guy I think that the Lakers could really use to sort of have himself a moment here in the last couple weeks of the season leading into what could be some really significant play-in game moments.
Look, I know that the Dinwiddie, since he's gone here, has talked all about how, he wants to be just a guy that plays defense really, really hard and just does whatever this team needs him to do to win games.
Yeah.
With the return of Vando imminent, and with Gabe already coming back, dog, what this team needs to do is to put the tech on ball in the hoop. And
yeah,
we appreciate you like really wanting to buy in on the defensive end of the floor, but we need you to like turn it around and start being aggressive and looking for your own shot. Like the three, I mean, a couple weeks ago when there was no Vando, there was no Gabe, we didn't know if they were coming back. Okay, we got to suck it up and be cool for right now, right?
Yeah,
but Gabe's back. Vando's coming back. You need Spencer Dinwiddie to be aggressive and look and searching for a shot. And Jeff, it was a while ago now where on the post game show, we looked at Spencer Dinwiddie's shot selection, right? And yeah, I brought up Spencer Dinwiddie the past couple of seasons. So going back to Dallas, even in last season, this season with Brooklyn, he was averaging roughly like a shot attempt every 2.5 minutes. Right. Okay. Or maybe it was like 3 minutes, but something around that range. And that's not accounting for free throws either. It's just like actual shot attempts are, taken down in the box score. So you maybe even depending on the free throws, you can add another shot or two.
Yeah.
At that time, since he had been a Laker, it was a shot attempt every 5.5 minutes almost. So, I mean, that is a very bad, probably a bad stat that I just made up off the dome that on that show. But I think that does kind of help indicate that he's not shooting the ball. He's not searching for his shot. Where we talk about bench scoring, you bring up bottom five bench scoring unit in the league. That's the dude that can score the ball. I think they are going to need him to start being more aggressive.
Yeah, no, I agree with everything you just said. And now when Vando comes back, we've kind of hinted at this. Does that mean Can they move a guy like Austin to staggered where he's maybe getting more opportunities to create with a unit of like a Spencer Dinwiddie rather than kind of linking him up with AD and LeBron as much as they have? I think that could help. But I said it. I think Dinwiddie's going to be a big X factor for this group.
I could be surfing. Are we solidifying the rotation yet? I think that's important in the playoffs. I don't think so. And the reason why I say I don't think we've like solidified the rotation yet, and I'm going to pull back up the minutes one more time, is because one, Vando is going to be a part of the rotation in the playoffs. Like,
yep,
for sure. But the reason why I don't think they are even close to solidifying this rotation is because you got these the most random Max Christie minutes ever.
Yeah.
Early in the game to the point. Yeah, we're at the point where I got excited. I'm like, oh my gosh, we are doing this. And they don't go back to him the rest of the game. And I'm not even mad at them for not going back to Max. Trust me, that's not what this is.
Yeah.
But what this is I just don't think the Lakers have a real rotation as of right now. To where the playoffs started tomorrow, there isn't anything that indicates, I'm sure they probably do internally, but there's nothing from how these games have played out recently to where you could say, yeah, they have a real rotation that they know, that we know even, that they are going to go to. And is that concerning? I mean, I don't know if it's concerning. It's not ideal necessarily, probably. But, I think that is a good point. And, yes, it is important to solidify that heading into the playoffs.
Yeah, I mean, and look, you've got the five, obviously the five starters. We just talked about Dinwiddie, who I think is going to be an X factor. He's six. Vanderbilt, seven. You know there's going to be a backup big. Let's call it Jackson Hayes. That's eight. I mean,
yeah.
Gabe Vincent, Torian Prince, like
I don't know. Those could be two guys that are on the outside looking in come postseason time, because you can't be running out a 10-man rotation in a play-in game that's a must-win.
Yeah, absolutely. Avon Trader said, we really need the Suns and the Pelicans to lose today. We played the Pelicans last game in the season, so if they lose, we have a chance to catch them. Yep, absolutely. Like we said, it does look like the Pelicans are in good shape to lose that game. And then Phoenix plays Cleveland tonight. I don't know if Donovan Mitchell's playing, so, I mean, you would hope he is, and hopefully Phoenix does lose that game. So really, really fast, to go over some tiebreaker stuff, and this is, and I really hope I don't get this wrong, so if I do get any of this wrong, please correct me, and we will make sure we get that fixed. I know Trevor's done a great job keeping up with the tiebreaker situation. The Lakers own the regular season series victory against the Phoenix Suns, which is important. They do not own the regular season series victory against the Dallas Mavericks or the Sacramento Kings, which is another thing to keep in mind. But they do own it against the New Orleans. Well, they can own it against the New Orleans Pelicans based off the last game of the season. And they do not own it over the Dallas Mavericks. And the Warriors, they're currently losing the series. But they can split based off how the game goes in a couple of or next week. So we look at the standings here. I'm going to pull it back up here. The worst case scenario, and Trevor's outlined this, the worst case scenario is last game of the year, or after last game of the year, there is a three-way tie, 7-8-9, between the Kings, the Suns, and the Lakers. That's the worst case scenario, because the Lakers would wind up being last out of those three, because, and again, I apologize, my language on this is going to be wrong, or incorrect, or just sound weird. It's the three-way tiebreaker is just going to be a cumulative record of all three teams against each other. And the Lakers would be last, because even though they were 3-2 against the Suns, they were 0-4 against the Kings, making them 3-6. And I don't know the Suns' record off the top of my head against the Kings and vice versa, but the Lakers would be last out of that three, making them, yes, head-to-head record between three teams. I probably could have said that. That would have been way easier to say. Now, again, good news is you have the season series over Phoenix. You have the season potential to win the season series against New Orleans. That's why this stuff is important, and we are game watching, our playoff standing watching right now for sure.
Good stuff.
All righty. Chat says Donovan Mitchell's playing, which is awesome. PSI8 says trap game, but still got the win. Yeah, I mean, I think Jeff said it doesn't matter if it looks pretty or whatever. What would you say at the start of the show? Something along those lines.
Yeah, it's not a beauty contest. Just get the win and leave.
That's what it was. Mamadou with a super chat says, I'm getting concerned about Austin's three-point shooting. Austin Reeves is in a slump for sure. And I don't know how you feel about this, Jeff. I'm more or less concerned about the timing of it than I am about like it being Austin, if that makes sense.
Yeah, you're not worried about long-term whether or not he can shoot the three, but we all know that shooters get streaky, and if you're in a cold streak when it matters most, it's not great. 2-for-6 tonight for Austin Reeves. And, you know, to be fair, one of those went off the side of the backboard, so that wasn't awesome. Going backwards, 1-for-5, 0-for-4, 1-for-7, 0-for-4. I mean, that stretch right there, 15, 2-for-20, 4-for-26.
I got 8-for-40 tonight. 8-for-40 from tonight, going back to that Milwaukee game.
Okay. Yeah.
But I mean, would you say it's comparable to like a really good hitter getting cold right before the playoffs, and like that maybe even translates to the playoffs? Would you compare it to that?
Yeah. I mean, look, I think all of momentum in sports is a real thing, and confidence matters, and so. If you're Austin Reeves and you're something like 6-for-38 or something from 3-point range,
yeah,
like there's just no chance you're going to be as confident that number 39 is going in as you would be if you were 20-for-38. And so timing is everything. You know, again, I'm with you. I'm not worried about Austin Reeves being a fluke shooting threes and sort of, you know, being crap at this long term, but long term doesn't matter if you're in a play-in game situation and it's one game to go. So he's got 5 games left in the regular season to maybe build some momentum. He's had some nights this season. You know, he was 4-for-11 in that Milwaukee game, which isn't terrible. He's got a 7-for-12 last month against Sacramento. So put one of those on the board. Get yourself some confidence, because the Lakers need. He had a couple really good looks tonight and just couldn't put it down.
I think, for one, you talk about confidence being important there. Jeff, there were shots tonight, you even called this out a few times as well, that Austin passed up looks.
Yeah.
And we had a situation. No, I'm not going to go that far, but I think I truly believe the only way to get out of a slump, if you're a shooter, is to shoot the ball.
Yeah.
You have to shoot your way out of it. Passing up looks, open looks, is not what's going to get you out of the slump. You need to keep firing, especially like the open ones. I'm not saying have like go full on Klay Thompson and just shoot anything, but the looks that Austin passed up on tonight, we're like, okay, man, Bron just created two players on the ball by driving and he kicked out of two. You're wide open. I don't care that you're six for your last 40 or whatever the number is. And I mean, really, if you want to eliminate the Bucks game and just go afterwards to the last five, that's 111, 115, 220. 426. Nobody cares if you're four for your last 26. Shoot the daggone ball because last thing you want to do is Austin isn't playing with confidence and isn't taking these open shots. And in playoff time comes around or playing tournament, if you don't qualify for the playoffs outright, the play-in rolls around and now you need Austin to take those shots and he's not in any rhythm anymore. So these last five or so games or whatever's left, it's five games. Like Austin, like get the confidence back, keep shooting the ball. I think that's super, super important for Austin. Tonight he was fine. 2 for 6 from 3, 7 of 15 overall, 16 points, only one turnover. Overall, fine game, but just passing up on some of the open looks. I think there were times tonight, and we've talked about this, where I think you could see his confidence just a little shaken.
Yeah, but we just said the Lakers need to go 4-1 in their next five. So, you know, which is it? Do you want the guy who's in a cold streak trying to shoot his way out of it? Or in a situation where maybe him shooting isn't your best option offensively, do you want to, you know, pass up open shots to go get, you know, something a little bit closer, make the pass, swing the pass to a guy in the corner type of thing? Mm-hmm. Like the Lakers, because that was, I think the situation is, it's one thing if you've got, hey, these three games don't matter, go get your confidence up, but they need them.
I would agree if, again, we're talking like shot chucking. So like the shots I'm talking about in particular are the ones where it's, I'm wide open, I'm not shooting. It's my biggest pet peeve is where, like I said, Bron or somebody drives, creates attention, and you kick out, and you're open, and you don't shoot that.
Yeah.
And then, because what oftentimes happens is the swing ultimately, like the swing, so I'm wide open, I swing it to you. 9 out of 10 times what happens is nothing. And that's a bad thing. Like nothing good generally comes out of that. And guys, we are not being negative about Austin. We're talking about like his cold slump and answering a super chat, which is, I think, very legitimate question. So again, we're talking shot chucking. I'm with you. I think it's, got to get these wins, but we're talking about him just not shooting open shots and just not shooting the ball well in general. And to that, where I would honestly say, Austin, we need you to play well. And if that means we're the 9 seed in the NCAA tournament, so be it.
Yeah, no, I think it's a good point. I think to the differentiation between, hey, shoot or shoot. And when you're open, shoot. We're not asking you to force it in the midst of a slump because we do need to play good basketball. But you can't be afraid to shoot either.
Mom Mentality says to piggyback, he's not saying to run the offense the right yard. Just hit, take open shots. If you miss, you miss.
Yeah.
Oh, well. Make the next one. Tevin with a super chat says, Lakers win feels good. Absolutely. Mom Mentality gifted a Lakers Station membership. Great time to plug the LakersStation.com membership program where you guys get exclusive access and perks, including our weekly members only live shows. Trevor does a great job with those. Occasionally I'll pop in. You'll get a bunch of the other Lakers Station staff members popping on. You guys get the opportunity to hop on stage with us and talk some Lakers hoops and a bunch of other great content and coverage there. Again, Trevor does a great job with the members only section of the channel. And then Chef Zach, who's been a member for 5 months, says, can someone please explain why our bench combined for 12 points? We should have almost lost to the Washington freaking Wizards. Well, speaking of almost, let's talk about why it was almost, because I feel like there's going to be a lot of of this for
Master Lock of the Night.
The mass lock of the night goes to the most frustrating thing. Jeff is ready. He's cracking his neck. He's been waiting for this moment. The most frustrating thing from tonight's game, we're going to put into our good friend Chris the Masterpiece Master's finishing move, the master lock.
Yeah. Justin Champagne. Justin Champagne. It's the master lock. Okay, with a minute 38 left in the game. The Lakers were up by 14 points. With a minute 38 left in the game, the Lakers were up by 14 points. There's some people, hypothetically, theoretically, potentially, who might have had Lakers to win by eight or more. Okay, so up 14 with a minute 38 to go against one of the worst teams, if not the worst team in all of professional basketball. Jordan Poole, three-pointer. All right, fine. 11, Rui gets one back. We're up 13. With a minute 13 to go, we're up 13, Sean. Eugene Omorui. Shout out University of Oregon Duck right there. Gets a layup. Fine. 11. By the way, my guy Champagne got the assist on that one. He's everywhere. Champagne's everywhere. 11-point lead, a minute 13. Lakers, Max Christie misses a layup. That's what the play-by-play tells me. Misses a layup. Champagne, 26-foot running pull-up jump shot is how the play-by-play describes that. Bang. Lakers up 8. Okay, so that's not great, but there's 27 seconds left. We got two possessions. We need one bucket or we need one stop, Sean. Do you think we got either of those things? The answer is no. Max Christie, 29-foot step-back jump shot, not anywhere close. All we need is one stop, Sean. All we need is one stop. 19 seconds left. Justin Champagne, 25-foot three-pointer, 125 to 120. Lakers win by 5. It got worse from there, but I don't care because my bet lost at that point. Champagne, Champagne, on the season, 31% three-point shooter on the season, 40% from the floor. He's not good. ESPN lists him as first-season experience. That's not right. He played on Toronto 2021-2022. 2022-2023, he was on Toronto and then Boston. And this year, 10 games played with the Wizards. So 51 career games, one career start, 31% three-point shooter, and the guy becomes lights out when I needed him not to be. So that's a long – that might be the longest master lock monologue you ever get. Justin Champagne out of the University of Pittsburgh, 22-year-old gentleman, master lock of the night.
Would you please, you know, be so kind to let us in on what the wager was?
No, it's not important. It's not important because if you've ever lost something like this, it's not even the dollar. The dollar, it could be a $1 bet. It could be a $1 bet. What hurts is how sad it was. How painful. I mean, they're up 14 against the worst team in the league with a minute 30 to go, Sean.
Jeff has a 75 cent bet. Yeah. And gives us a...
over here. I mean, just like, it's bad. It's bad.
75 cent bet rants for 5 minutes. I wonder what it would have been for a $100 wager.
Yeah. Yeah. It's again, it's like the show. Money doesn't matter. It's the pain of Justin Champagne, who, as somebody pointed out, ESPN doesn't even know the guy. ESPN lists the guy as first-year experience. And 6 points, 2.9 rebounds, 1.2 assists on the year. He wears 99, according to ESPN. I don't know if that's true. Yeah, you go. ESPN literally doesn't even know who this guy is. Oh, there you go.
Choco Thunder says, Mavs lock the Lakers needing 6 minutes to beat the zone. Yeah. Yeah. Oh my gosh. That was so freaking frustrating.
Yeah.
That was so
frustrating. New Orleans has the lead down to 8 with a minute 12 to go, Sean. Just as a heads up.
Come on, Magic. Pull the win out for me. Oh man. I think the very Chad wants you to take a breath, Jeff.
Yeah, we're good. We'll be all right. Matt Peralta, the optimist, he's at me on Twitter, says, hey, Dodgers money line tonight. He likes it. That game, by the way, just started. Tyler Glasnow on the mound. I doubt we're going to get great odds. On that one. But, you know, we're not chasing bets here. Okay? We're not chasing bets. That would be irresponsible. We're chasing wins. Yep, you could say that. But, you know, obviously Mookie Betts already on base in the first. So we'll be all right. We'll survive. We had a good day overall. Net positive.
He's so insane. Jeff has to mortgage his house now.
Yeah, we'll be all right. House is still going to be here. Kids are still going to be able to eat breakfast tomorrow morning. So gamble responsibly, folks.
Oh, man. Okay. My master lock of the night, and I love him. I really, really do. He was one of my favorite players in last year's draft. But Maxwell Lewis, man. I don't even remember, like, the play, because it was such a blur.
Yeah.
Where all I remember, Sean Penny hits the three. I think Spencer Dinwiddie inbounds the ball, and I thought he traveled, but the play-by-play says out-of-bounds turnover. And I'm just like, bro, no, what that? Okay, I might have lied earlier, Jeff. I might have lied about this. There was never a point where I thought the Lakers were going to blow it. Not going to lie. For 2 seconds, I was like, this game is going so poorly right now where the Wizards can get just freak lucky right here. Corey Kispert's going to hit a three out of this timeout. We're going to do something stupid and turn the ball over. And at the very least, this game's going to overtime.
Yeah.
All you had to do, Max Lewis, just is catch the ball and stand there. And we somehow find a way to turn the ball. I need to find the play. Because like I say, I don't even remember the play all the way.
Yeah.
That's how much of a blur it was. But
somebody pointed this out on Twitter. Colin Castleton and Maxwell Lewis, they each played 1 minute. They were -8. Their plus minus was -8 in 1 minute. So that kind of tells you everything you need to know about that night for those two guys.
And yeah, that turnover, Brown was so mad after that turnover. Yeah,
he's pulling his, he's got, I got to get back in this game. Anthony right, Davis, by the way, shout out, block on the last play. But
yeah, thank God for Anthony Davis, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Good grief. So my master lock is Max Lewis. Max, love you, but good grief.
Yeah.
Just hold the ball.
Yeah, that's brutal. Yeah, 1 minute, no stats, one turnover, -8 in the plus minus. It's not going on his Hall of Fame plaque.
All right, last comment of the night here. Bucks about to lose to the Grizzlies. What's up with them? Did they officially lose to the Grizzlies? Yeah, they lost 111-101. I know that Damian Lillard didn't play tonight, but you still had Giannis. So, like, in my mind, that is not an excuse. You're playing a Grizzlies team with no Desmond Bane and no Ja Morant. You're supposed to be a title contender. And this goes to the point. I'm going to end the show. We're going to end the show on this. There was a video I saw that came across my feed, and it was along the lines of the Bucks are not that much better than the Lakers, if they are at all. And the point was, they're both like, he brought up the point of how, you know, the Lakers and the Bucks, like, stylistically in terms of the roster build, they had some similarities there, right? And he brings up how you look at the Bucks, you look at the East. The Bucks get to play Washington in extra time that the Lakers don't get to play them. They get to play the Pistons 2 extra times than what the Lakers get to play. They get to play the Bulls an extra couple of times than the Lakers would. Like you just look at the Eastern Conference, where the bottom 7 teams legitimately all stink. Like, the Bulls are not a good basketball team. The Hawks are not a good basketball team. The Nets are awful. The Raptors are just bad. Now, when healthy, the Raptors are okay. The Hornets are awful. The Wizards are, I mean, I know you only won by 5 tonight, but they're bad, legitimately. Like, Jeff, there were points in tonight's game we were like, what are we watching? This is just such bad basketball. And then the Pistons are just disgusting. We all remember that historic losing streak they went on at the start of the season.
True.
Comparatively speaking, to where you go to the Western Conference, and even though the worst teams in the West, like San Antonio, has,
I mean, San Antonio and Portland suck. I think they belong in the same category. But once you move past those,
not
two
San Antonio, because of Wemby.
They have 18 wins.
Yes, but my point is, it's just such more of a dogfight. You play Detroit or Washington, or okay, I guess not Washington, but the Raptors currently
should be Washington,
or it should be Washington, right? That is as almost as much of a guaranteed win as anything is in the NBA currently.
Yeah.
You play the Spurs, you should win. The Lakers didn't; they lost against the Spurs this year, but they got Wemby. They actually have real dudes on that team. I'm not saying like those other teams don't.
The Wizards have Jordan Poole, all right? No disrespect to Jordan Poole right over here, Sean.
They have Kyle Kuzma. Sean Kuz. But Memphis, Jaren Jackson Jr., Bane, Utah. Utah's kind of tanky now. But like, bro, the Lakers are there. If they're in the East right now, the Lakers are are in competition for the 3 seed right now. And we're talking about the Lakers potentially losing in the play-in tournament because we're in the West.
Roy does point out the Wizards also have Champagne, too.
Can't forget Champagne.
No.
So I think that was a really, really good point. The Bucks are frauds. Yeah. I don't view them as like a top-tier contender, regardless of them having Giannis, because like I think in terms of like contender tiers, if you were to do a tier maker, the Lakers and the Bucks are in the same tier. It's just one team plays in the Western Conference that also has, in my opinion, the best player in the league, and the other one's playing in the East, where you get to beat up on scrubs half the year.
No, the reason I have optimism of any kind for the Lakers is because it's, hey, get me into a playoff series with LeBron and AD and I'll take my chances. It's the same logic that you would apply to the Bucks. Obviously, the Bucks have a much better, you know, or I shouldn't say much. They have a better regular season record. It's like 3.5 games better than the Lakers, something like that. But playing against worse competition, I think those are all fair points. Basically, the argument for both of them is, well, you wouldn't want to play Giannis and Dame in a 7-game series, which is true. You wouldn't want to play LeBron and AD in a 7-game series, also true. So I think it's a fair point that they're both in the same tier. And just pointing out, look, the Bucks have 47 wins. The Lakers have 44. So I know one is in second place in their conference and the other is in ninth, but they're only a 3-game difference in the win column. And if you want to go into who have they played, strength of schedule, that kind of thing as well. I think it's a lot of fair points.
Last thing to wrap this thing up into a little pretty bow. Do you know which team in the NBA, Jeff, has the most wins against top 10 teams?
No idea.
The Lakers. Can't be Denver worth anything, but anybody else.
There you go. Everybody in the chat had it.
On that note, everybody, thank you guys so much for tuning in here to the LakersNation.com post-game show. Again, Trevor, night off. He was with the family. Me, myself, and Jeff, we were able to fill in. I thought this was a fun show, Jeff. Appreciate you so much for hopping on with me, bro.
Yeah, absolutely. Folks, check out Dodger Blue 1958 on YouTube. Dodger Blue 1958 on social media as well. Sister site connected to Lakers Nation. We cover the Dodgers, obviously. We do live post-game shows Tuesday nights, Friday nights, live podcasts on Sunday nights, as well as content throughout the week. So Dodger Blue 1958. Would love to have you guys join us over there if you're a Dodgers fan.
Yeah, absolutely. Make sure you guys go subscribe to them. They do a bunch of great stuff. And that's going to wrap things up for us. Thank you guys again for tuning in. Till next time, everybody. See ya. Stay safe and peace out.